Welcome to worship at Speedway Christian Church. I'm Scott Cox, Senior Minister here at Speedway Christian, and I'm delighted that you have joined us, whether you be a regular attender, whether you be a homebound member, whether you be a guest. This is the first time you've tuned in. We're excited that you have joined us on this Sunday. I have a few announcements I want to share with you. Women's book study on Thursday evenings at 6:30 p.m. will continue. It is on Zoom. They are reading Liturgy of the Ordinary, Sacred Practices in Everyday Life. This week they will be looking at Chapter 2. If you have any questions about that, you can email Katie Griffin, our associate minister, at kgriffin@speedwaychristian.org for more information. It has been decided not to offer Sunday school for children for the time being. This will continue until it can be determined when a good time for the Zoom class on Sunday mornings can be, by having three worship services beginning next Sunday. However, Sunday school resources are continuing to be available on the OneDrive. You can check your email for a reminder about that. On Wednesday, Zoom gatherings continue at 6:30 p.m. We're leading a discussion of finding courage in challenging times. Our Reverend Marilyn Shank is leading that. If you're interested in participating, let Marilyn or me know. Each Monday at noon, I'm leading a Bible study. We focus on the scriptures for the upcoming sermons. The study is by Zoom, and if you have interest in that, let me know. Plans continue to be made to have in-person worship next Sunday, June 21st. The services will be live-streamed, or at least one of them will be live-streamed. If you have interest in that, tune in next week on Facebook, our Facebook page, or our YouTube page. There will be three in-person worship services, as I indicated earlier. One is at 8:30, the other is at 9:45. That's when it will be live streamed. And then there's 11:15 worship service. A link will be sent to you by email, so you can click on that if you're watching it live at around 9:45. You can click on that. And the service will also be recorded, so you can watch it at a later date if you would like to do that. You should have received an email or a letter in the mail this week indicating some of the procedures for worship next Sunday. We're doing everything we can to take care of the health and well-being of everyone who will be in attendance. So there are a few changes that will take place for a while in order to do that. If you did not receive that email or letter, please call the church office tomorrow and let them know. That email indicates which service you would like to attend, whether it be the earliest one, the one in the middle, or the later one. Please contact the church by email, as I said, so you can indicate which service you would prefer to attend. One more reminder. There are three ways that we can contribute financially to the church. One is by writing a check and sending it directly to the church by mail. You can also go on the church's website at www.speedwaychristian.org and find the Givelify icon and click on that and follow the directions. Or you can set up automatic deposit with your bank. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in these past weeks and your contributions. God bless. Thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. We come to this time of worship where we can bring our needs and longings. Each of us have traveled different roads and conceived diverse thoughts this week, but underneath lies the same basic need for love and acceptance. And so we worship, admitting our need for love. Let us celebrate the most marvelous news that God loves us and accepts us as we are. Let us pray. Holy One, in this precious time, we pause to hear your word for us. To do so, we break from our responsibilities and from our self-absorption. We move from fears that overwhelm and from ambitions that are too strong. Free us in these moments from everyday distraction, that we may focus to listen, and that we may hear, that we may change. Amen.
Circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8
Sarah said, God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. And she said, who would ever have said that Sarah would nurse children? And yet I have borne them a son. We have come to our children's moment, a time for all of our children and for those who are down in heart. And so, as you may have heard, today's story is all about surprises. And so I know that as a kid, you do surprises very well. You surprise other people, other people surprise you, maybe as a joke, maybe in lots of different ways. So, a long, long time ago, back even before Jesus, there was a woman named Sarah and her husband named Abraham. And God told them they would go on. They were like, oh, this is great. And God was saying, he was such a wonderful leader. Extraordinary leader for the whole world. But then, after they finished celebrating, a year passed, and then another year, and lots of years. And so Sarah and Abraham were thinking, no, oh, this isn't really going to happen. God's breaking his promise because we're really old. One day, God comes along and says, guess what? You guys are going to have a baby. And they both laugh. Like, Abraham laughs so hard he falls over. And God's like, no, really, you guys are going to have a baby. And so they do, and it's wonderful. And they name their baby Isaac. And he does indeed go on to be an extraordinary leader. And so if you want to learn about him, you should go to the book of Genesis and Exodus and the whole Bible and learn all about these fantastic leaders. And so, I think the story of today teaches us that there are lots of surprises in the Bible. There are this surprise for Sarah and Abraham. There are surprises that Jesus came again. The Red Sea parted, and God helped them to escape to freedom. And maybe the biggest surprise of all that we all know so well is when Jesus rose from the dead. And so I think these surprises teach us that just when we think things have gotten bad and maybe really scary and maybe weird and we're uncertain about what's going to happen next, we really just want something good to come along in our lives, that God's there waiting with a surprise in store. We just have to have faith and we have to look around and we have to watch for God and how God is at work in our lives. So let's try to do that this week. Let's pray. God, we thank you for all of the surprises you bring to our lives. Help us to look around for you, especially in those moments when we may be scared or worried or just having a difficult time. Help us to know that you are with us beside us all the time, helping to guide and lead us and make us feel good. Amen.
Let us pray. Move us, God, with your truth and your love for the world and everything in it. Open our minds and our hearts to the word you have for us today and give us faith to trust you with our lives. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We've heard a portion of the story of Sarah and Abraham. We heard it from chapter 18 of Genesis and chapter 21 of Genesis. But it helps us understand Sarah and Abraham's story more if we look at the preceding chapters, those preceding chapter 18. Beginning with chapter 12, we hear God's promise to Sarah and Abraham that they would have was 75 years old at the time, and Sarah was 65 years old at that time. In chapters 13 and 15, God reiterates the promise to Sarah and Abraham. Yes, they would have a child. In chapter 16, Sarah was so tired of waiting for the promise to be fulfilled that her patience wore thin, so she took things into her own hands. She had a slave girl named Hagar, and Sarah told Abraham that he was to go and be with Hagar, and Hagar would provide the child that God had promised. The plan seemed to work. Birth to a son, and his name was Ishmael. Abraham was 86 when Ishmael was born. I'm sure that some things about this aspect of the story bother us. I know they do me. There is the fact that Sarah had a slave, and there's the fact that she ordered Hagar to sleep with Abraham, Sarah's husband. These things are troubling, but they are legal and were legal in that culture. Not that this makes them morally acceptable. I'm sure that there are things in our culture which people will look back on years from now and consider them morally unacceptable. Nonetheless, the fact is that Sarah did try to solve the matter with her own planning, which at first seemed like a good move. But Ishmael's birth caused all kinds of problems. If you've read the story in Genesis, you know that. We're told that Hagar had contempt for Sarah, but more than anything, Sarah was jealous of Hagar, even though Sarah was the one who devised the plan. It grew into a family triangle between Sarah, Hagar, and Abraham. All of this reminds us of what can happen when we try to usurp God's position in our lives. And then in chapter 17, we read that Abraham was 99. But God still kept promising Sarah and him that they would have a child. It wasn't Ishmael whom God had in mind. And Abraham laughed at the promise. In fact, we're told that he fell on his face because he laughed so hard. This was not the laughter of joy over the fact that he believed that he would have a child with Sarah. He laughed because he was 99 and Sarah was 89, which meant that by the time the child was born, Abraham would be 100 and Sarah would be 90. So Abraham laughed at the impossibility and absurdity of it all. Perhaps he also laughed because he preferred to laugh rather than cry. That's why Abraham proposed to God this: let Ishmael be the child you have promised. But God said, no, Sarah and you will have a child together. On a side note, I'm glad that God also promised to take care of Hagar and Ishmael. God promised that Ishmael would also have many offspring. And then we get to chapter 18, from which we've heard, verses 1 through 15. In fact, part of this story is strange. We're told that there were three men who came to Sarah and Abraham's tent. But the reference to these men is interchanged with the reference to God. It's not exactly clear what took place, but we can say that God appeared to Abraham, whether it was in the form of three men or another form. Now, some Christians have argued that these three men were the Trinity, but we need to be careful about reading Jesus back into the Old Testament. Jesus does not appear in the Old Testament in any place. Regardless of this strange part of the story, once again, Sarah and Abraham were told that they would have a child. And Sarah said, after I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure? And Sarah laughed. No wonder her words were like a punchline to a good joke. Like Abraham, she also laughed at the impossibility of it. Fred Buechner says that Sarah laughed at the prospect of having a baby in the geriatric ward and Medicare would pick up the tab. But I suspect, like it was for Abraham, her laughter carried up her pain because for 24 years, God had promised him a child and it hadn't happened. After Sarah laughed, as we heard, God went to Abraham and said, "Why did Sarah laugh?" And Sarah overheard the exchange between Abraham and God, and she denied that she had laughed, probably because she was embarrassed at being caught. God didn't seem to sympathize with Sarah's laughter because God confronted Sarah about her disbelief and the laughter that accompanied it. As we heard, God responded with words which come across rather harsh, it seems to me. "Oh, yes, you did laugh." And then there is a line which is at the heart of chapter 18. God said to Abraham, "Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?" Some translations have God saying this, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" Others say, "Is anything impossible with the Lord?" Another has God saying, "Is anything too difficult for the Lord?" Regardless of exactly what the question was, it was intended to be rhetorical. We know that the writer had in mind that whoever read it would say, "Of course, nothing is too wonderful, nothing is too hard, nothing is too difficult. It would be a child, nothing is impossible with the Lord." God, for 24 years you have promised Sarah we would have a child, and it has not happened. Obviously, some things that even you can't do. The question has been misunderstood in some circles. Some say that if we simply have enough faith, that God will provide whatever we want. But as Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann points out, that faith doesn't make everything desirable possible. What is possible is everything that God has promised. Only what corresponds with God's good purposes is possible. God hasn't promised everything that we see. But, as I said, in chapters 12, 13, 15, 16, in our reading from chapter 18 today, God kept promising Sarah and Abraham that they would have a child. But no wonder Sarah and Abraham couldn't believe. No wonder they would have answered, "Yes, there are some things that even God can't do." Sarah and Abraham had been portrayed as models of belief. The book of Hebrews in the New Testament of the Bible indicates that they were. But as Walter Brueggemann points out, at this point in the story, Sarah and Abraham are models of belief, but of disbelief. It's understandable that they didn't believe. They were models of belief when they left their home country in Ur because they believed that God was calling them to go elsewhere. But they had to have many moments of doubt even after that. It had to have happened when they were in the land of promise and a famine came. And so they made their way to Egypt where they heard that there was food to be found. And then there's the one line in chapter 15 that indicates Abraham did believe. But other than that, Sarah and Abraham aren't portrayed as models of belief. But I don't know if anyone has full-fledged belief or is a full-fledged model of belief. I remember when people were surprised, perhaps even shocked, when Mother Teresa had periods of doubt and disbelief. Belief and hope are up and down affairs in our lives. I think of what Progressive Baptist minister Carlisle Marty once said. He said that he believed in the resurrection on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, but he didn't believe in it on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. He said that on Sundays he did believe because he had to. He was a preacher. What Marty said about the resurrection can be said about many aspects of our faith and our hope. There are days when I am virtually certain that God is with me. The presence of the Holy is almost palpable. Then there are days that I wonder if God is anywhere to be found. It's hard to have hope on those days. Some Major League Baseball fans know what it is to lose hope. When we have a favorite team and they disappoint us year after year, there are only so many times that we can say, wait till next year. For 86 years, Boston Red Sox fans tried to hold on to the hope between World Series championships. Time after time, some fans said, wait till next year. But there were some who gave up. Cubs fans can relate to waiting and losing hope. They waited 108 years between World Series championships, but it finally happened. No longer did anyone say until next year. The poor Seattle Mariners fans. The Mariners are the only team never to appear in a World Series, let alone win a World Series. I'm surprised that their fans still hold on to hope. Sarah Abraham, on a more serious note, had resigned themselves to the fact that they would never have a child. Sarah and Abraham had grown accustomed to Sarah's barrenness, so they ceased to hope. In fact, they probably feared hoping because they had been disappointed too many times to think that something impossible as them having a child could possibly happen. They saw it as nonsensical and crazy to believe in it. So they gave up. They threw in the towel. When we've gotten our hope up over and over, we've been disappointed over and over sometimes. And after a while, it's hard to be hopeful. I've heard it said that expectations are recipes for disappointments. That sounds cynical, but it can sometimes be the case that we can relate to that. That's why hope can be a hard thing to muster up. We might even, like Abraham and Sarah, fear hoping when we have been hurt so many times. What is it in your life that has disappointed you over and over so much that, like Abraham and Sarah, you have thrown in the towel? But finally, we read in chapter 21 that Isaac was born. And after Sarah gave birth, she said this, God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. Now her laughter was one of joy, not disbelief. And others would join in laughter as they rejoiced with Sarah and Abraham. And just as God had commanded in chapter 17 of Genesis, they named their son Isaac, which means, you guessed it, laughter. By telling them to name their son laughter, it was as if God were saying, I join in the laughter with you. We would expect fireworks and a big party. We would expect a long birth announcement. But the writer presents it in an understated way. Here's how the writer puts it. The Lord dealt with Sarah, and the Lord, as the Lord had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as the Lord had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, whom Sarah bore him. That's pretty much all that is said about the birth in this chapter. Maybe to add too much would have ruined the story. Sometimes less really is more. Maybe what the writer intended to do was to let the reader simply soak in the wonder of the whole story, to soak in the fact that God's movement in Sarah and Abraham's life wasn't dependent on their believing. It was based on God as who God is. And that's why, even though he was a boy, Isaac laughed could just as easily have been named Grace.
Thank you.
people in your homes, probably small children, that you can barely find a time for yourself. And for those, we pray for all of you and send you our love and our prayers, and cannot wait until we can get back together for worship once again in person. And for those who do not regularly worship with us, know that you are in our prayers, and we are sending you our love as well, as our great God envelops us all. And so as we go to the time of prayer, I invite you to join me in a moment of silence, so that we might lift our hearts to God with our own prayers. Let us pray. God of love and life, we come to you today struggling. The weight of loss and grief, of uncertainty and anxiety is threatening to break us. The ways of injustice upon injustice, violence upon violence, are drowning our hearts. Our black neighbors have lived in a world of racism and violence and fear for over 400 years. We have often done little but look away, knowing the system is so big and falsely thinking that we can do nothing to stop it. All our brothers and sisters around the world have been huddled in our homes for so long, maybe suffering, maybe lonely. Our loved ones have died from COVID, from other illnesses. We have become ill. Our children may have missed so many experiences. It so often feels as though life has been put on hold. And so in this time, help us to understand truly, deep within our bones, understand what it means to love our neighbors as ourselves. God of hope, show us how to work for justice together, standing up for what is right, stepping in when something's wrong, shouldering each other's burdens, holding each other accountable, righting the wrongs we've done, speaking truth to power. In our doubt, when we struggle to see, when we wonder what we could ever do as one person to change anything, help us to remember that we are not, in fact, simply one person, but are part of a huge patchwork of people who, in living our ordinary lives, have fought for justice and peace and love throughout history, and will continue to do so far into the future. And that such a web would be incomplete, without each of us, without the gifts that you have given us for this moment in time. And so today and every day, may we be a movement for wholeness in our fragmented world, and may we see prisms of beauty that you bring through broken windows to our world, and that we would know joy in the morning. Amen. So as we come to our time of giving, it will not come as a surprise to any of you that my heart has been heavy recently, these past few weeks, just knowing all the struggles that everyone is going through in this world. But in this moment, we also know that in the midst of all of our struggles and all of our days, that God is present. In times of grief, in times of weariness, in times of tragedy, God weeps with us. When we fail to be the people that we know that we should be, God's grace envelops us. God beckons us to live with God's unfolding realm of love. And so as we prepare to give today, respond in openness to all that we've been given. As you commit your offering, do so silently committing to God to use your gifts, your talents, and heart for further the unfolding realm of God on earth. Let us pray. Only when we come to you in gratitude for walking beside us always. And in this time of so much uncertainty and pain, and so much of the inequalities of our world are laid bare, help us to take these gifts of money and the gifts of ourselves and use them so that all will know their worth and your love.
It is indeed hard to hope sometimes in our personal lives. It's also hard to hope in the midst of all that is going on in the world. It's hard to trust. It's hard to overcome our fear. But one of the ways that we are reminded that we can have hope is at this table each week, where we come to take bread, receive cup, tangible reminders of the presence of Christ in our lives. Tangible signs of the presence of hope. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're welcome to stay. Let us pray.
Faithful and loving God, we pray that you would quiet our hearts and still our minds as we come to this communion table. Today and every day, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the sunshine and rain, for forgiveness and grace, for good times and bad times. Because we trust in you, Father, we know that even when things are difficult, when all hope seems lost, your love and faithfulness will carry us through. And Lord, we pray that evil will truly be overcome by good within your kingdom. Open our eyes to see your work in our world, and help us to be the people that you created us to be, compassionate, loving, faithful, and kind. Help us to treat others the way that we want to be treated. Father, please bless this communion meal. As we partake of this bread and cup, remind us of the great price your Son paid so that we could all be free. Help this communion to feed our souls and nourish our hearts. Now let us lift up the prayer of our Lord, our Father, who art in heaven.
As we come to the table, we recall that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he met with his disciples in an upper room. And when he was at the table with them, he took a loaf of bread. He blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Let us pray. God, you are the source of all our hope, and it is at this table that we are reminded of this as in tangible ways we experience the presence of the living Christ. We offer our lives to you that we too might be signs of hope to a world in desperate need of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One more reminder, we will have worship in person next Sunday, June 21st. We'll have three worship services. The first is at 8:15. It's at 8:30. The second is at 9:45. The third is at 11:15. You're welcome to come to any of those, but please call the church office or email the church office indicating your preference of worship services. We will have proper spacing in our worship service, which we will be able to do if we have the appropriate number of people at each worship service. So please call in or email the church office. A reminder also that the second service, 9:45, will be live. So if you have decided that you were not quite ready to come to worship next Sunday, then you can tune in for a live broadcast at 10 o'clock or 9:45. And then you can watch it later if you happen not to watch it live. As it is a gift that we may serve God, let us accept the ministry to which each one of us is surely called, rejoicing in the blessing of our Creator God, continually renewed by God, and hoping in the presence of God. May you know peace and joy this day.